box. Stop. Look and watch. Ready yet? Get set. It's all that. Hello, everybody. This is your boy, Marlon Ballard, with the Love to Laugh podcast. I am joined by the very lovely Christy Knowings. Those of you that don't know Christy, I feel bad for you because she is our childhood. You've seen her on All That. She's an original cast member. She was on Sesame Street. You can see her on social media singing her soft. She can sing. I love Christy. I watched you growing up, and I'm glad to have you on the show. How are you doing?
I am fantastic. I'm happy to join you. Yeah, for sure. I'm doing really well. How are you?
Everything's good. Everything's good. Man, it's I don't know. It's like a nostalgia thing because like I grew up really like watching you. So I'm like, yo, I got her on my Zoom show. Yo, I'm happy as hell right now. Man, so
I'm always happy to do. Yeah.
I want to start off with the beginnings. So you're from the Bronx, New York, correct?
Yes, I'm from the Bronx originally. I did spend a lot of time born and raised.
Okay, from the BX. How was it growing up in the Bronx when you were there?
It was cool because, you know, being a New Yorker, you don't just stay, well, I didn't just stay in one borough, you know. Even though I'm from the Bronx, I went to school in Manhattan. So a lot of my friends were from Manhattan, you know, Upper West Side, Harlem, you know. So I had a multicultural experience because New York is so diverse. Just from all the different cultures and, you know, all the different flavors of New York, it just kind of, as a composite, influences, you know, a person growing up there. So, yeah. I think that's where I get a lot of my accents from and characters and stuff.
So. You have a lot of accents and characters. You have millions.
I do. I almost came on the show and just started, like, talking like this just because I felt like, you know, like, this is actually how I really sound. So, you know, like nobody actually knows that.
that's what kidding. I call the Idris Elba effect. Like how he's so like American in movies, and then like when you talk to him one on one, I'm like, wait a minute, where'd that come from? Well, hold up now.
A lot of people are like that.
Wolverine,
Alfred Enoch, okay. From Harry Potter and from How to Get Away with Murder. I mean, obviously he's in Harry Potter, so I should have known he was English, but he did such a great American accent on How to Get Away with Murder. I was just like, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So I'm actually doing my American accents 99% of the time. Yeah.
I bet you played on people's phones a lot, didn't you?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I did. Everybody made me prank call their grandma. So
you was up there stirring up trouble with all this talent. did they call your mom? Was like, hey, yo, yeah, she playing on my phone again.
Yeah, it started out that way. Oh yeah, I mean, and I, you know, just because I'm a vocalist, I can change my pitch, you know, so I can change it. I have a quite a wide octave range, so I go from a contralto, which is like deep like Nina Simone, all the way up to a coloratura soprano, which is like Mariah Carey. So, you know, I can sound like a little kid, like all the way up here, you know?
Or I could, you know what I'm saying, bring it all the way down, you know what I'm saying? Like,
so and I would scare people.
That's talent right there. That's talent. Like, and I see why they had you on the show, because I'm like, yo, this girl has a range of characters, and she can hold her own, like with Keenan, Kel, and Nick Cannon. Like, you can hold your own, and I'm like, yo. And then at the same time, you can sing, which I didn't really know back then. Did like when you wanted to sing, did people take you seriously? Did they was like we want to see you act? They like, what was that like?
You know, I, at that time, I mean, like, I sang my entire life, but I mean, really, since I was 8 years old, I really, was really singing, even publicly. But when I was on Nickelodeon, the focus wasn't necessarily on singing, like, and I think I wasn't taking it like a career seriously. You know what I'm saying? Like, I wasn't taking singing, it was just something I could do. But then when I left the show, it became a lot more prominent in my life, singing. So, or singing professionally. And like I said, I was always singing, but then I started classically training, like opera. So that only enhanced my, you know, natural ability.
Okay, so you pretty much took singing lessons after you left the show.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, just to get like the music theory down, just to get the logistics down, so I wasn't just singing, because a person can actually hurt themselves if they're not singing properly, you know. Which really? Is why some singers don't last. You know, you'll hear their voices when they start out, and then by the time they hit concert after concert, performance after performance, their voice is blown after like a 10 year period. You know, then it's like, wow, they don't really sound the same, and that's because either they're not training or they're not training properly.
Yeah, and see, you just put me on to something right there. So now I know. I'm like, okay, when this person doesn't sound the same, they've actually been hurting themselves all these years.
Yeah.
Man, okay. Yeah. Hey, make sure you keep your voice intact. Honestly, Christy, you haven't changed. You still look like you're on all that right now.
Thank you. I appreciate
that's cocoa butter and Jesus. That's what that is.
Cocoa. some shea butter. I am vegetarian, mostly vegan, although there's times where cheese it's just sometimes cheese gets to me, and 8% vegan, so
okay,
so I don't know, that may help. And plus, you know, designer jeans, familial ancestral designer jeans.
When did you become a vegan?
I started basically, the last time I ate meat was at the end of the last day of 2001.
Oh, wow.
So ever since then, I haven't had any meat. Pause.
So you're a professional vegan.
I mean, like I said, I can't really claim complete veganism, because I do have moments of cheese outbursts where I just have to have it, but I try not to make a habit of it, so yeah.
Gotcha. Okay. I asked a couple people had asked me questions that they wanted to ask you.
Cool.
So going back to you working on all that, did it feel like a kid's show when you were working on the show, or was the vibe of the show mature?
It was mature in a way. You know, it was definitely mature because there's that level of professionalism that you have to have. But at the same time, you know, we were kids, mm-hmm. and some of us were young adults also. You know. I mean, but so I think it was you know, there had to be a happy balance between, you know, having the professionalism like as an adult would, you know. are moments of being silly and running around set and, you know, getting into a little bit of trouble and, you know, I learned many lessons. Let's put it that way.
So who discovered you and told you to audition for All That, or did you just happen to just go and wing it and happen to get the part?
I was doing another Nickelodeon show. It was like a special. It was like a 3-day special, and it was called And Now This. And at the time, I really was inspired by Rosie O'Donnell, because like, she's a female comedian, and she had her own show. She was from New York at that, you know, she had her own show, and it was a cool talk show. So I really liked her, and she was going to be on this this special. And I told my agent, I was like, I do not want to do extra work. I was like, I don't want to do extra work. And so literally a week later, they were like, well, Rosie's going to be doing this special for Nickelodeon if you want to do it. Like, bet. So I did it. Rosie wasn't there, but my brother came with me. You know, I have a twin brother, and he showed up with me because we would go with each other anytime we booked a job, or even if we had auditions, we would go with each other. And so he went with me, and during our break time, during our lunchtime, we were sitting in the green room, and a couple of the casting directors from Nickelodeon were there. And this one girl who was starring on the special, she was from Long Island, and she was doing a Long Island accent. So I'm like, okay, big deal. You're from Long Island. Like, I'm not surprised you can do a Long Island accent. Yeah. So my brother was like, yo, why don't you break out a bunch of your accents? So I just ran down the line, like maybe 10 or 11 different accents and characters. And they were like, you know, All That is looking for a new person, a new girl. So you should audition. How come you haven't auditioned with us before? And I'm like, I don't know, my agent, you know? And, so then it just happened, bada bing, bada boom. It was like 1 week after the other. Like I went into Nickelodeon. They just filmed me doing a bunch of characters. And the week after that, Brian Robbins and Mike Tolan, the producers of All That, and a bunch of writers flew in from LA to New York to come see me. And then 5 minutes after, they were like, how would you feel about moving to LA? So it happened really, really, it happened within a span of a few weeks.
Man.
But it was happenstance, because I just happened to say to my agent, like, had it not been for the fact that I said to my agent, put me on to some extra work if Rosie O'Donnell was going to be there. I did the extra work. Rosie wasn't even there because she was coming the next day, but I still did it. It felt very mapped out, like divinely mapped out, you know, like I was definitely supposed to be on the show, you know.
And did you ever get a chance to meet Rosie?
Yes. As a matter of fact, I ended up doing two or three Kids' Choice Awards where we won for best show. All the seasons I was on, we won for best show at the Kids' Choice Awards. And Rosie was hosting two of those years. And I ended up presenting with her 2 years in a row. So that was just full circle. It was super cool.
Oh, man. So you make it onto the show, and then you see all that's like, how did it feel being around other people that's talented just like you, from Josh to Danny to Lori to Keenan to Kara?
It was such it was surreal, you know, because I had watched the show, you mm-hmm. know, because I was part of seasons 4, 5, and 6. Mm-hmm. So there, you know, 1, 2, and 3 had already been established, and you know, I had seen the show, and I had seen, of course, Keenan and Kel and Lori Beth and Amanda at that time, and Josh, and I came on with Danny. Like, we came on at the same episode.
Okay.
Where I'm playing his best friend at his house, and the cast of All That flies to Danny's house and invites him to be on the show, and then he's like, oh, can my friend Christy be on? And so then I ended up joining the show, you know, and Leon as well. But yeah, it was surreal. It was surreal, you know, because like I said, I did watch the show. I was I was fond of the show. I was a fan. And then to be on it after that was just really amazing. I felt like I needed to hold my own because there was this unspoken initiation that happened mostly, I think. Well, at the time, I felt like, you know, the OGs wanted to make sure I could hang. Yeah. You know, and then I think I when I finally got that like approval from Keenan and Kel, I was like, okay, I can do this, you know, because they thought I was funny. So,
man, and all that I believe held its own because even like everybody from a kid to an adult watched all that at the time.
Like, at that time, absolutely.
Y'all was holding y'all's own with the likes of SNL and Living Color had just ended when all that started. So
that's right.
You could tell Josh was mainly influenced by Jim Carrey because he did a lot of falling, a lot of tumbling. I'm like, that's Jim Carrey influence, right?
Oh, there. Yeah.
And then Mad TV came after y'all. And then the Chappelle Show. So, like, y'all was holding y'all's own with, like, a very top tier of sketch comedy. And
yes.
Like, it was, y'all did amazing. Y'all held y'all own and became household names. And
yeah.
Like, how does that feel to like to have such an impact on like a bunch of new 90s kids, you know?
You know, it's funny because at that time we didn't have as much access to our fans.
Yeah.
Right?
Social media.
Unless we were doing a tour or unless the fans actually came to the show and we would sign autographs. Unlike now where it's like, I can actually see my fans and I can talk to them and I always communicate with them. I never, you know, doesn't matter who they are. I make sure to at least communicate with them unless I just miss a message or something or miss a comment. But it's super cool. You know, I feel so grateful to be able to be part of something that created this kind of legacy and put a mark on. I mean, I love making people laugh. So I do improv comedy right now. So I feel like I'll always have it, you know? So it's good.
What was one of your, you had a lot of characters. What were a couple of your favorites that you came up with that you just absolutely loved doing?
I used to, there's this one character who doesn't get seen a lot because she came later. And so I think we busted out as many as we could. Glory, there's this one character, I do, her name is Gloria Bankhead.
Yes.
And it's like this like whole Martha thing. Stewart, right? And she's like, happy homestead with Gloria. Yeah. And she is, I would walk around set before we amped up in full character. Like I would be talking to the cameraman and I would be talking to the script supervisors and the, you know, just all kinds of crew as this character, you know. It was so much fun. And then I also got to work a lot with Gabriel Iglesias, you know, during with that particular show, with that particular sketch. They put us up a lot. So that one, and then I love the later versions of Brenda Stone. Because yes. At first I was like, oh my God, I'm exhausting. And then, and then towards the fifth and sixth season, I really enjoyed pulling that character out because they gave Brenda, at first she started out with Josh with like, you know, she in the studio and then Josh would be, she would be tormenting Josh because he would be someplace ridiculous. And then later on, it just became Brenda by herself and she would just do these things by herself. And I, you know, I enjoyed all of it. So I really love Brenda. You know, I love the Whatever Girls too. I love doing Jessica because she was a lot of fun. There were a bunch of odd bit characters that I did enjoy doing too. But those were some of my main ones that I definitely enjoyed. Yeah.
It was one sketch that two sketches that I loved you in. The CJ and the Cloudy Nights. Mm-hmm. It was Disco.
Ha ha. Yes. And I played Kel's girlfriend.
That stood out to me because it felt like it felt real. Like I was really watching a band argue in the 70s with Froze and whatnot. And then you wanted them to change your name to. So I'm like, yo, this is the Five Heartbeats all over again right here.
Yeah, no, it was that was a lot of fun. I mean, the costuming alone was it was cool. But yeah, it got us to play some really, you know, the crazy characters. It got us to play some crazy characters. I mean, the scene that I did in the convenience store with Nick and Keenan.
Yes.
That was
hilarious. That was like, it was like, I'm like, I see why adults are tuning into this, because this is adult humor borderline, but it's like, it's hilarious. They're like your kids making people laugh universally.
Right. And you got to remember, at that time, Keenan was probably already like 22.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Nick, not that far away from that. You know, we were all, I mean, I wasn't quite that, you know, mature yet, but it was so cool. Like, you know, just to be the writers and producers really let us go out on a limb, you know, so we had full creative license to do, to kind of, because some of the stuff you just can't write, you know, some of the stuff can't be written. Some of the stuff is just ad libs from the talent.
So a lot of the sketches y'all did were in front of a live audience, correct?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, like that one.
So what?
Yeah,
what
in front of a live audience. Only time the live scenes weren't done with. Oh, go ahead.
What was the best and worst thing that happened in front of a live studio audience?
Let's see. Best. Let me start with worst, because I think maybe I can kind of conjure that up real quick. worst thing that happened in front of a live audience. You know, I don't think I had. Trying to think. I don't think we had any bad. I don't have any bad moments.
You didn't trip and fall over nothing. You didn't accidentally forget like a line. You didn't.
Oh, we forget lines all the time. Okay. You know, but that's just a hold. You know, that's just hold. And then, you know, we start over. But I was good about remembering my lines. I was good about remembering my lines. I think I just. You know, there were times when I was in the beginning, when I first started on the show, I was super nervous, you know, I was very nervous. And, oh, I know. The first season, I don't remember her name, so I'm happy I don't remember her name, because she was bad to the point where they had to replace her with one of my favorite makeup artists, Michael Johnston. And, you know, so I think I went out there looking crazy. Like the first season, Jessica was like, what is she wearing? You know, and what kind of makeup is that? So that was embarrassing later on to not have a good enough makeup job, because, you know, it doesn't go away. You know, that's forever embedded. In season 4 of all that, it's horrible makeup for me, at least. I don't know everybody else deciding to. Hey, there you go. Real life.
And what's the best thing that happened?
Some of the best things that happened was. When Destiny's Child came, I'm sorry about my dog. She's just gonna bark. So, like, one of the best things was with Destiny's Child came to set with us, and they performed on the show. So that was really cool. They weren't as big back then.
Yeah.
So you didn't know the magnitude of, you know, what we were experiencing exactly. But definitely, you know, definitely super cool. I did Brenda Stone by herself, and I was just flying, you know. So my last season, we just got really good, you know. The acting was on point, the comedic timing was on point. We were all super familiar with each other at that point. So it was definitely a good look, you know.
Absolutely. And speaking of the musical guests, even though all that was labeled a kids show, y'all had a lot of adult, mainly black musical guests. Like from yeah. Drew Hill to Erykah Badu to Casey and JoJo to, I'm like, yo, these are some adult acts, and they're performing in front of kids. And I'm like, yo, I wonder, are they nervous? Because like Drew Hill, I believe, came on there and sang Tell Me, and we know the lyrics to Tell Me. I'm like, how are they doing this in front of kids?
No, it was a different year, because it's like kid music, you know, here. I don't know if we wanted to just, I was listening. You know, TLC doing to a host of different was really good. I mean, it's good now, but, you know, don't get me wrong, but it just hit differently, you know. I mean, we had kid acts also. We had this one kid, Sammy, you know.
Yeah,
we
Sammy had, was a kid then, yep.
We had Sammy. We had, I'm trying to think of some other, you know, we had Immature.
Mm-hmm.
So we did have some of the groups that were younger, but... Yeah, I don't know. We just had, amazing acts, and many of them were, we had Deborah Cox. It was like,
yes.
What? Like, now it's like, oh, okay. It's all right. And she grown, you know?
Grown. And you said Destiny's Child. That was your favorite musical guest, was it Destiny's Child?
Well, they were one of my favorite. Okay. Spice Girls actually did a scene, several scenes with us. So, you know, that was a lot of fun. All the behind the scenes of the Spice Girls day was kind of funny and amazing. So I enjoyed that. And that's when you talk about, you know, the difference between adult, like, was it an adult environment or was it a kid environment? We were surrounded by adults doing adult things too, you know, you know, not holding back. So, you know, you just had to kind of roll with the punches. But yeah, Destiny's Child was definitely one of my favorites. I'm trying to think. We had Missy Elliott too, and so Missy was one of my top for sure.
Missy, man, mm-hmm. that was such a great time for music too, as well. Mm-hmm. So when you saw them performing. Like, did you want to get up there and, you know, sing with them? Because you had pipes then too, I'm sure.
Oh yeah. But you know, it's funny. I wasn't as confident in my. I was so confident as a comedian. But I've had it honed in, and I had already been writing songs and all of that. But I was still pretty private about that. I didn't see myself. I saw myself as a singer. But I didn't see myself as, like, you know, a pop star or an R&B star or anybody that could, you know, even though I knew I could sing, you know, it just wasn't fully in my face like that, because what had been taking over my life at that point was acting. So, you know, but now I do both, and that's cool, you know.
Absolutely. And then after... So pretty much you did your tenure on all that, and then after that you went to Sesame Street, correct?
Yeah, I did a few episodes of Sesame Street because my brother is a series regular on Sesame Street for many years now. So it's like we end up doing the same things all the time. It's so funny because when I was on Nickelodeon, he was on Nickelodeon on a completely different show called Tyena. And then
I forgot about that. Man, so pretty much y'all were, it was a competition thing with you two? I remember this song now. Man, that was a classic too, right there. Then, yeah, I remember your brother because he
never
actually never one of my favorite movies, Crooklyn.
It's so funny. I think because we're twins and maybe because he is a boy. Oh yeah, I mean, you should get some Italian people on your show.
Oh, definitely. Absolutely. And you know? And y'all are talented, so pretty much your parents are proud of both of you. That's all that matters right there.
I like to think so, yeah.
All right, so y'all are talented. Like, I'm sure your parents are both proud of both of you because, hey, you did your thing, your brother did his thing, and so pretty much when the holidays come, your mom looking at both of y'all like, so who gave me the best present this year, you know?
She's like that all year round, to be honest. My mom's like, no, she's awesome. My mom's the best.
That's good. With things going on right now, what have you been doing during the coronavirus? Have you been in the house like you're supposed to be, or have you been out just partying like everybody else is not supposed to be?
No, I haven't been partying. I'm like, where are these parties? I haven't been partying. I mean, not that because I don't want to, but no, I haven't been doing any of that. I stay in the house anyway. So like when things popped off, I was like, I'm okay with that. Like, I'm okay with staying inside a little bit. I mean, I pretty much do the things I normally would do. Like I said, I do improv. I do improv every Friday night, but it's via Zoom. And then we do like a YouTube live. So I've been doing that. I've been writing a lot. I'm working on a fiction book, and then I'm working on a nonfiction book simultaneously. And I'm writing music constantly. You know, I'm writing music when I'm here. And yeah, I have been using a lot more social media. You know, I've been on social media probably a lot more than I ever have been. So.
Yeah, I listened to your songs on your YouTube. You had Fusion and Cream Brulee, right?
Oh, yeah. Okay, so those are older songs, but yes. Fusion was a project I did a while ago, and that was I like wrote and directed, and I did I was everything for this one video that I created called Fusion. Yeah.
It looked very like a fun video. I'm like, you're just having fun. Like there's no
right.
There's no Maybach Benzes. There's no, you know, making it rain. Like it was just like you just having fun. You dancing. You singing. Like that's
yeah. That was the initial concept, was for it to be like a fashion meets music kind of piece. I wanted to show the sides of myself that are more masculine, more, you know, and then that's what Fusion was about. It was like fusing the sides of myself, like the fashion side of me, the musical side of me, the acting. And then alongside the masculine versus feminine side of me, you know, I mean, not like I'm a man or anything like that. I'm 100% female, but just, I think everybody has, you know, that masculinity and that femininity, which allows them to be both receptive and aggressive. So, which you need a balance of, in my opinion, you need a balance of that in order to navigate any kind of, you know, hardcore industry like acting or music or any of the arts, you know, or business, you know, you need that receptivity, you know, to be able to listen to people, to be able to nurture. And then you need that masculine aggressiveness in order to take action, to go after what you want, you know, to create boundaries, all of those things. So I don't look at masculinity and femininity as in terms of boy and girl or male and female, but more in terms of, you know, action oriented and receptive oriented, if that makes any sense.
That makes sense. What is do you have any regrets during your career that you need to? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think not getting the right management. not, you know, applying carpe diem, seizing the day, like not applying that, you know, I didn't know a lot. There was so much I didn't know. There was so much business acumen that I didn't have at the time. You know, I did not have the business acumen that I think was necessary to maintain, you know, just maintain what I was becoming, which is what Nick Cannon had on lock.
Yes.
That man has been professional probably since he was a baby. Like,
yes.
He worked his way up from being the audience warm-up guy, because he was, you know, comedic mm-hmm. and wiry, and, you know, to being a featured on our show, to being a full-blown cast member, to then having his own show, and then from there, just taking off. So,
yep.
Yeah. I have a lot of love and respect for Nick, always. Man.
It's like everybody pretty much branched out and did their own thing. Now there, like mm-hmm. there's a stereotype about, you know, child actors, mm-hmm. you know, how they grow up and then, like, you know, they say, yo, they went crazy or whatnot. I think Nickelodeon has the best track record of child stars that grew up and, you know, did their own thing, because you have Disney. I mean, you see Orlando Brown out here with the umbop, doombop, doombop, doombop.
Yeah, so much. You know, TMZ reached out to me a while back, and they were asking me about, they were like, oh, Lindsay Lohan yeah. is saying that Nickelodeon kids are treated better than the ex-Disney stars, you know, and they were trying to ask me to, you know, basically, they really wanted me to, I think, kind of gossip about what I thought about Amanda Bynes versus yeah. Lindsay Lohan, which I really wasn't willing to do. I'm like, it's not my nature to really just throw anybody under the bus and try and, like, dog them out. Like, that's just really not my style. But I was like, if either of them need, you know, anybody to talk to, I'm here for both of them. What? You know, and I was very good friends with Amanda. Amanda and I were really, really close when we did work with each other. It wasn't high bye, and, you know, it was like we insisted with each other. So I can't, I would never, you know, throw anybody under the bus. Although I think Nickelodeon builds a very strong family, you know, so we built some amazing bonds. They were very skilled at picking not just people that were you know, just amiable, good people. So, because I can say that about every single person I've worked with on the show, they were very good people, and they were good to me, each and every one of them.
Gotcha, man. And I'm glad you cleared that up, because I'm like, I hear that stereotype all the time, and like I said, Nickelodeon bred some, like, legit people that went on. Kenan's on SNL. Like, Amanda's, like, to me, Amanda's somewhere, like, living life. I think she's somewhere enjoying life. She wants nothing to do
with yeah.
stardom. And I can accept that. I'm like, okay, she gave us her childhood. You gave us your childhood.
Yeah.
Pretty much. So you need a break.
Right. You know, it's like, how much more do you want? You know, I mean, I think that's the thing that people forget, is that these kids are people, you know, and even if they grow up, you know, it's like, go back and watch some of their old videos if you need to see them. Hey, I'm happy for Amanda. I think, you know, she probably is. She's doing what she wants to do finally. She's not under the thumb of her parents, you know. Mm-hmm. She's just doing what she wants to do, so I'm happy for her. Yeah.
Absolutely. So I was out in LA last summer, and that's when they had the Good Burger pop-up.
Oh, I love the Good Burger pop-up. It was so cool.
What made me mad about that was when I went, and then I flew back here, and then I see them promote, like, hey, we're having a reunion at the pop-up. I'm like, they would have this damn thing now that I left. And I saw you on the bill, Sinbad. I think Lori Beth was there. Nick showed up, I believe so. And, like, what was your experience with that? Did it feel nostalgic to you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yep. It was so fun. I was excited to see everyone, thrilled to have seen Nick later on and his children. And so, you know, he got out the car and was immediately, wasn't any like, oh, I'm Nick now and who are you? He grabbed me right up and it was like no time lost.
Yes.
So that was just dope. And then I become friends with, oh, I haven't seen Nick since, you know, I haven't seen Nick since doing stuff with Nickelodeon. You know, it's been a long time, you know. But I think about him all the time, and you know, he's still family to me, which is why when he saw me, it wasn't like, oh, can I holler at you for a minute? Like, he came to me and was like, you know, so we're family, you know. I think we're always going to be like brother and sister, have that Nickelodeon family vibe. So what was cool was, you know, now I've made friends with like Elisa Reyes and Angelique, you know, some of the people that weren't on the show with me, but, you know, are still obviously part of the All That family. So, yeah. So that's cool.
One thing I haven't covered yet, what I really want to know is, I know I've been skipping around, but we're going to edit this up and make it sound good. Who musically influenced you growing up?
You know, it's hard to say like who I was influenced by, but I tell you, I listened to a lot of my mom's music. Mm-hmm. So, and I listened to like Michael Jackson. I think he's always going to be somebody that influences me. Stevie Wonder was a big influence. Earth, Wind & Fire, Phyllis Hyman. So I'm pulling out some OGs right now.
You know you mean.
But this is my foundation.
Man, this has been the Love to Laugh podcast. Yo, Christy has joined me. Like, I've had so much fun with you. And hey, it might be a part two. You never know. Like, hey, we can do this on the regular.
Let's do it.
So I appreciate you doing it. So before I go, you know, for the nostalgia in me, can I just get a whatever from you?
See, I'm holding my phone. So now I can't. Let me just do the West Coast whatever.
Just do the little Wu-Tang W or something.
Okay.
Love it. I appreciate you so much. Thank you so much, Christy. You're a sweetheart, and I appreciate you. So this has been the Love to Laugh podcast. I am Marlon Ballard, joined by Christy Knowings. Thank y'all so much for tuning in.